Hello everybody, thank you for the opportunity to speak to you today. My name is Dmitry Baranov, I'm a researcher at the Italian Institute of Technology, and I'm very excited to share with you our latest results. So let's get going. The topic of my talk is the hidden role of nanocrystal reactivity in photoluminescence of self-assembled perovskite nanocubes. The work was performed in collaboration with CNR Nanotech in Lecce, Italy. The nanocubes I'll be talking about today are what we call shape-pure ones with about 8 nanometer edge lengths, as you can see from this TM image. They were synthesized by a hot injection route with oleic acid and didodecylamine surfactants and benzoyl bromide as a halide source. This synthesis, described in this paper in nanoletters, produces nanocubes which show sharp excitonic absorption, as you can see in this spectrum, in this black spectrum, and narrow photoluminescence. Because they are shape pure and very uniform, they assemble nicely into supercrystals, which I will be calling superlattices throughout this talk. And here on the lower left corner is shown an optical microscopy image of a sample showing isolated superlattices with almost perfectly square profiles. Up here is shown a confocal photoluminescence image of one of the superlattices, which shows a uniform green emission. And when we extract the spectrum, PL spectrum of this superlattice, shown here in the black line, and overlaid with a PL of nanocubes in solution, in dilute solution, shown here in the green line, we see that changes are really minimal in going from nanocubes in solution to a thin superlattice. The reason is that nanocrystals in the superlattice are separated by 2.5 nanometer thick layer of insulating organic ligands, which effectively prevents any electronic coupling at the ground state. So later, the samples were shipped to our collaborators in Lecce, who several days after their preparation cooled down superlattices to 4 kelvins and measured their PL spectrum. And this is what they found. The spectrum is shown in red, and the superlattice in question shown here. It's a reflectance image. So what they observed is that PL shows two peaks, a broader high-energy peak and a narrower peak at lower energy with some sharp spikes. We got quite excited because this observation matched nicely that previously reported and interpreted as superfluorescence from a similar system. So if it's indeed a collective phenomenon, then a faster photoluminescence intensity decay would be expected from this peak, which we checked with the streak camera measurement, and indeed we found that the lifetime of this redshifted emission is about 2.5 times faster than that of the broader high energy emission. So is it indeed a collective emission then? So the question we asked, however, was what is the spatial origin of this redshifted emission? Since we can take advantage of micro-PL, we can see where it originates in the real space. And when we image superlattice in the real space, we saw that it is covered with bright spots. Next, we spectrally and spatially filtered the emission bands and saw that there is a correspondence between bright spots contributing to the lower energy emission while the rest of the superlattice contributing to the higher energy broad emission. So the question became, what are these bright spots? To answer that, we investigated a replica sample by high-resolution scanning electron microscopy. And we saw, indeed, superlattices covered with particles, with the crystalline particles on their surface, which also appear bright due to higher electron density, and which turned out to be bulk-like cesium lead bromide 3 crystals sitting on top of self-assembled nanocubes. The reason for their presence is that keeping the sample in air, the sample of superlattices in air, resulted in nanocubes reacting with oxygen and water and sort of recrystallizing, if you will, into these bigger particles, which are in turn contribute to the photoluminescence. So next, we ask the question, can we characterize photoluminescence of just these bulk-like crystals without any nanocubes to make sure that indeed they contribute this lower energy narrow emission? For that, we intentionally aged nanocubes in solution and then separated, formed larger bulk-like particles, cooled them down to 4 Kelvin and recorded their photoluminescence. And it is shown on this slide. So what is shown here is three streak images collected from an area in the sample at three different laser fluences. So at low laser fluence, the sample of bulk-like cesium lead bromide 3 nanocrystals show a single pale peak with a lifetime of around a few tens of picoseconds, which is much faster than the radiative decay of small nanocubes. However, as fluence is being cranked up, the decay shows something very interesting, namely an oscillating behavior, oscillating intensity. So there are two maxima at 80 microjoules per square centimeter, and then at least three discernible maxima at 800 microjoules per centimeter square. Again, an oscillating decay, oscillating fast decay, something which have been previously interpreted as superfluorescence. In this case, it clearly has a different origin. So the question becomes, what happens with a pristine superlattice which has not been exposed to air? What its true photoluminescence response at low temperature? So to do that, to answer that question, we made superlattices, promptly placed them under vacuum and cooled them down, and only saw a single peak without any lower energy sidebands. However, a week later, after keeping the sample under vacuum at room temperature, a week later we re-examined it and saw that PL drastically changed. Of the same exact superlattice in the same sample, the photoluminescence peak underwent a dramatic redshift and got much narrower. So again, superlattices threw us a surprise, as there seemed to be some slow reactivity going on even in the absence of air. And this reactivity is coalescence of nanocubes. So here, what is shown is a couple of ways how we characterize this coalescence. So first, we simply dissolved freshly made superlattice, which expectedly gave just same nanocubes, and a weak old one, which also contained bigger particles. And then we monitored the aging of superlattices under vacuum by X-ray diffraction over multiple days and identified two regimes. The first regime, which happens during the first couple of days, is superlattice contraction, which is manifested by the shrinking of superlattice periodicity, which gradually transforms into formation of bulk-like phase and decrease in the volume fraction of the nanocrystals, which continues for over a month. Here, this cartoon depicts this aging process and its effect on photoluminescence. So when superlattice is fresh, it's made of the same nanocrystals, which emit and produce a single peak. Over time, as they coalesce into bigger particles with smaller band gaps, these particles start dominating emission due to energy transfer. So here we arrived at putting it all together scheme in which we kind of dissected different pathways of how nanocrystal reactivity in superlattices affects their photoluminescence. So if freshly made superlattice stored under vacuum, it ages through coalescence and produces age-dependent redshift. If it is stored in air, it produces bulk-like impurities on their surface, which contribute redshifted photoluminescence. Also, if starting solution of nanocubes is stored in air, nanocubes react with the air and produce bulk-like particles, which have this fast and oscillating photoluminescence intensity decays. And then, if this process goes unnoticed and you self-assemble nanocubes, you form superlattices already containing the bulk-like particles with a congested photoluminescence spectrum. So there are a couple takeaways here. First, we were looking for collective properties, and we found them, except it's a collective reactivity of nanocrystals, which we assign to be a source of rich spectroscopic phenomena. And the practical consequence of these findings is that surface chemistries which prevent this reactivity and are compatible with high-quality self-assembly are badly needed in order to continue studying collective properties of these fascinating materials. With that, I'd like to thank you for your attention and acknowledge several co-authors who participated in this project, specifically Antonio Fieramosca, who performed most of the low-temperature photoluminescence experiment. Follow us on Twitter for updates from our group at IIT, and I'd like to thank the funding from Marie Curie Fellowship and IIT Nanochemistry for supporting this research. Thank you. I'll be happy to take questions and start discussion.